this video, we're going to go over the basic steps to build the Hello Purr basic app. Right? So part of the lab is a basic Hello Purr example. So first we want to make a project and we call it Hello Purr. Hit enter or press OK. And we are taken to our project. We see a screen, and so we notice that we need a few components according to the lab manual, and we're required to use a button, a label, and several media options. Okay, so let's put the button, right? Our button, right? So the point of the app is to make a kitten purr. So our button we'll use for user interaction, and then our label we will use for instructional purposes, right? We want to tell the user what to do, so we need a label, okay? And then in order to produce sound, we have to have a media, a sound component. Drag that there and it'll show up down here. So now we have a button, a label, and a sound, and those are the three components we'll need for our app. So let's go through and set some properties to make them slightly more pleasant and slightly more adaptable to our application. First, we want to set our screen properties. Okay, so our app name, as it should show in the app drawer or applications drop-down list, is Hello Purr, but we want a space there. There really should be a space. We want to set the screen orientation to portrait mode, okay? Because as we will see later, our media file for our picture of our kitten is a portrait picture, so it makes sense to limit the screen to portrait mode. Okay, and then we will set our icon when we get the media file for that icon. Our title screen, we only have one screen, so we don't really need a title. So let's eliminate the text and then make it invisible by unchecking the box. All right, we can also uncheck the box for showing the status bar to make our full screen application. All right, so we've set our screen settings. Now we can go through and set our button settings. First, we want to rename our button to something useful. Okay, so we rename our button from button 1 to kitten button. Alright, and then we can rename our label to instructions, and our sound to purr sound. Okay, so in our kitten button, we don't really need text, we want a picture, right? So let's eliminate the text, and that's good. Now we don't have any text, so our button sort of disappears, but it'll come back when we put our picture in. For our label, we click on it, or we click over here in the components to select the instructions component, and we want the text to say, pet the kitten. Okay, hit enter, and it updates. It's kind of small, so we'll make it size 18, and we'll make it bold. Okay, so that works well. And then our sound, we can't set our source yet because we don't have media. So in this media box, we need to upload all of our media. There are several media files in the lab folder, and we've downloaded them already, so that we can easily upload them. So you should download them with your lab, and then you will upload each of these individually. So the sound, and then the picture we're going to use, followed lastly by the icon. All right, so every app that you build should have an icon and should have a name. Doesn't make sense to leave those blank or unset, right? So proper development dictates that you should pick those. You notice that our names kind of get cut off here, right? So if we have long names in App Inventor, they end up with this dot 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 in the middle. So if you have a lot of names that look the same, this dot 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 may make them all look the same, and you're missing the information that you need to identify them, one versus the other. So you might want to shorten your names to help you pick through the media if you need several of the similar names, right? We want short names. For here, we can see one's the picture and one's the icon, so it'll suffice. All right, so back to setting our properties. Our button will have to have an image, and that picture will be a good setting for it. Now we see that it's really big, okay? So we also notice that our label has been pushed way down, so our instructions are no longer on the screen. So we can go to the height and width. The width we might want to leave as automatic, but let's say we want to fill only 90% of the screen height with the picture, right? Then it makes sense to set 90% there, so that kind of squishes it down, right? Now we want the width to only fill the parent, right? Which means that we'll go edge to edge in this case. All right, that looks much more acceptable as far as a picture. And we can see our label now too. Still says Pet the Kitten. Okay, so we have our height and our width set, and we have our picture set. So we're done with the button, okay? And we make sure it's visible. If it's invisible, it disappears, right? Instructions, we're set. We set the text, we're good. The purr sound, all right? We want to set the source. We gotta choose our sound, okay? So now we've gone through and set all the designer components for our app. Right, we have a button, instructions, and a sound. But we don't have any logic, we don't have any code to make the app actually work. Right? If we ran this app right now, we'd have a button that does nothing, and a label that tells us to pet the kitten, and a sound that never actually plays. Right? So if we go over to our blocks view, we notice we have a clean slate like we expected, and we want to go through and add our interaction. So our interaction is the clicking or the tapping of a button, right? So we look at our button and we have all these events that we can handle, right? So clicking the button, we can then do something when the kitten button is clicked, right? And what do we want to do? We want to play our sound. And we also want to vibrate our device, right? So we notice that we're missing something right here. If we look and show the warnings, we'll actually see a little triangle warning sign. If we click it, it says you should fill all the sockets with the blocks. So these are the sockets, right? So we need something here, and it's a number of milliseconds. So our number literals are actually under math, right? And they're just numeric values that we can type, and we'll say 300 milliseconds, right? So essentially 3/10 of a second, okay? So when the button is clicked, we will play the sound and we will vibrate the device at the same time as we're playing the sound. And we'll do that for 300 milliseconds, the vibration. All right, and so that is all the blocks we need to have our app, right, which pets the kitten, makes a sound, okay? So those are the basic blocks. Now we go to connect, and we say, oh, we want to choose one of these options. So if we're using the Kindle Fire, we want to connect use USB. If we're using the emulator on our computer, we'll connect to emulator. If we're connecting to our own devices, we can use the AI companion. Right? And this requires wireless, being on the same wireless network or the same network as the computer you're coding on. Right? If something goes wrong, if you've already connected, you can choose one of these options to reset the connection, hard reset, right? And then these three will become available again. Right? So if we click one of these, say USB, right? It'll go through and try to connect USB. Right? So if you haven't launched the AI Starter program, so if you're in lab, this means that you started the browser improperly, right? And you have to start, remember, we have to start it with our CS005 script. So we have to press Alt F2 and then CS005. So you want to save your work and then go through and launch the browser properly. If you're at home and you get that message, then you didn't start the AI program correctly, or maybe you haven't gone through and set that up yet. The other ways to connect, right, are these three ways, but there's also, if you want to just build the application and send it to your device, we can do that. Okay, so if you have a device handy, you can always send it directly there rather than testing it out through the AI companion. We build and run on our device. Okay, those are the options we have available. Most of the time we just want to test, and if you're getting checked off, you're just going to test with the Kindle Fire over the USB. And if you want to save and share your actual app for others with Android devices, you save your APK to your computer, and then you send it along or put it in Google Drive or somewhere that your friends can access, and they can download it on their phones, Android phones, and then install it and have a digital kitten.